Hello, I am Victor Danchev from EnduroSat, and today we're going to be talking about one of the most important topics in terms of communication and signal processing in general. And we are going to be talking about waves. First, we're going to talk about the simplest possible waves. Those are the sinusoidal waves. And so we will be speaking about the simplest periodic functions, which you have seen at school, the sine function. And then after gathering some momentum and seeing how to describe simple plane waves, we are going to go on and describe the most general case of a wave, of a periodic signal, and introduce the Fourier transformation, which is one of the most important tools used in signal processing and in communication in general. To begin with, you must have heard of waves at some point in your life. We're all familiar with the term, and perhaps the word wave, the first thing that comes into mind when you hear of it, are the surface waves in an ocean, or maybe the waves on a guitar string, or maybe even some of the more exotic and recent findings of gravitational waves, which are disturbances in the gravitational field itself. But what we're going to be focused on throughout this course, due to its applications to communications, are electromagnetic waves. And we are going to see how the electromagnetic waves are different from those in an ocean surface or those in a guitar string in a while. And we are going to see, however, first, how to describe waves in general, since the description of a wave is universal, regardless of what kind of wave we're talking about. And so, what do we understand by a wave? What do we mean when we say we have waves? Generally, considering waves in a media, considering waves in, for example, a pond or in air, my speaking right now is also a form of wave process. We consider a wave to be a periodic, both in space and time, function, which propagates through the media, but it does not move the media itself. And so, you can see on the slide, if you consider a wave, it is not really moving any particles of the media, it is just making the different particles oscillate around their positions. And so, waves in that sense carry momentum and energy, but they do not carry material itself. We are going to see that this is true for this very specific material waves, as we said, but in general, electromagnetic waves are a bit different. They do not even require a media to propagate. They propagate in vacuum. And in fact, we're going to see that our definition will broaden a little, and we are going to consider electromagnetic waves to be periodic oscillations of the electric and magnetic fields. Why do they exist? We'll see in a while. But before moving on to this specific case, let's consider how a wave should be described in general. So, the simplest function, which we're all used to, which is periodic, is the sine function. And just to give you a quick reminder of its properties, you might have forgotten since high school, the sine function is a periodic function with a period of twice pi. That means that if you move the argument of the function by twice pi, or equivalently 360 degrees, what you get is the same function. And so this is what we mean by periodicity. If you move the function by a certain period, it becomes itself. It fits exactly back into itself. And so, of course, our definition of a wave was something periodic and both in space and time, as we're soon going to see. So the simplest way of constructing a periodic function is with the only periodic function we know from high school, that is the sine function. Now, some of you may argue that the sine function is not the only one we know. Some of you may argue that we also know the cosine function, but as we'll see shortly, they are in fact one and the same, only translated by 90 degrees, or by pi divided by 2. So those of you who are uncomfortable with working with radians, I am going to explicitly say any argument in degrees as well. But you should be used to the fact that twice pi equals 360 degrees, and the radians are in fact a bit more natural to work with. Now, how do we go about constructing a wave from the sine function? Well, since we want periodicity in both space and time, we should consider a sine function, which is a function of both space and time. But in general, our waves should not have a period of twice pi. So we would like to consider any wave with any period in time and any period in space. And in fact, we can construct this by forming a ratio between twice pi and the period we're actually considering. So The period in time is called just that, it's called period. While the period in space is called wavelength, since it is the length at which the wave repeats itself. And so in a sense, we can form these two ratios. We can form twice pi over t, twice pi over the period in time, and twice pi over lambda, which is the wavelength. And these two ratios are quite important, as we'll shortly see. And they are, in fact, called the angular frequency and the wave number. And we are going to use them to construct a general wave. By using them inside a sine function, you can see on the slide that the property of this angular frequency, which we have included, this ratio of the original period of the sine function to the new one we desire, it has the property of turning the sine function into a periodic function with any period we decide. So plugging in twice pi divided by t as an argument to the sine function gives us periodicity in time by the period t. If we include the same ratio, twice pi divided by lambda, in periodicity by x, we get the period lambda or wavelength of lambda. And so this is how we construct a wave, in a sense. Now, we should include both of these in the sine function, since our function oscillates both in space and time, and you may consider this to be the simplest form in which we can do it. So we have a sine function, and the argument is the combination of omega t and kx. And so it's a combination of the angular frequency times the time, so the time period, and the wave number times the position, so the position period or wavelength. And however, there is an ambiguity in this case. So we can pick the sine to be either a plus or a minus. And this ambiguity, although you may think is not important, it tells us what kind of wave we're looking at. So the plus sign corresponds to a wave traveling to the left in our one-dimensional coordinate system, and the minus sign corresponds to a wave traveling to the right. And as you can see on the slide, the difference between the two is simply the direction of propagation. So the wave has the same angular frequency, it has the same wavelength, but the direction at which it propagates depends on the sign in between these two ratios, omega t and kx, these two products. And we're going to see this shortly. We're going to get a sketch of a proof that this is true. But before going there, let's consider a bit of a generalization, since this is not really the most general type of wave we can consider, even in one dimension. What we can add, and we recall that the cosine was simply a sine function displaced by pi divided by 2. So what we can add to a general sine wave is an arbitrary initial phase. And so if we consider our wave which we have constructed so far, and then if we add an additional constant in the phase, so in the argument of the sine function, what we get is the same wave but starting at a different point. And so this is what we will mean by phase, the argument of the sine function. So if the sine function has a phase 0, this means sine of 0, this is simply 0. If the sine function has a phase of twice pi, this is again a full circle, so this is again one period of the sine function, and it's again 0. And so by changing the initial phase, not the whole phase, but just the initial part of the phase, we actually change when the wave starts, because at the initial moment for t equaling 0 and the initial space coordinate for x equaling 0, the initial phase, which we have denoted as phi here, it determines actually how the wave starts. So does it start as a sine with zero amplitude, or does it start with a higher, with a different point in its amplitude? And so this initial phase paired with the amplitude of the wave itself, so how high it goes, the A number here, and paired with omega and k, defines our sine waves uniquely. So what we have seen so far are only one-dimensional waves. We only have, you could say, 4 degrees of freedom. We have A, which is the amplitude, we have omega, which is the angular frequency, we have k, the wave vector, and we have phi zero, which is the initial phase. Now you may think there are 4 degrees of freedom, but in fact there are 3, since there is a relation between omega and k, which we're going to see right now. We can consider the waves, and we can think of the question, how do they move? What's their velocity? Okay? When we think of a physical object, when we think of a, for example, a car, we can define its velocity by the amount of space it traverses for a given time. So how do we define this for a wave? How do we define the velocity of the wave? Well, one of the easiest way to do it is to consider the phase itself. So considering all of the points in space and time which have the same phase, which corresponds to this equation here, the whole argument equaling a constant, and taking the time derivative, so differentiating this expression, since the derivative of a constant is simply zero, we get the following, perhaps weirdly looking expression, omega plus or minus k, depending on the sign of propagation, times the derivative of the position with respect to time, equaling zero. So you may recall from basic high school physics that the derivative of the spatial coordinate with respect to time gives you velocity. And so this dx dt actually has a dimensionality of velocity, and this is one kind of velocity which we can define for a free wave. It's called the phase velocity, and equating the two, we can see that the phase velocity is minus or plus omega divided by k. And so we see that the phase velocity of a wave, of a free wave, is actually its angular frequency divided by its wave number. And if we look at what each of those was defined as, so if we look at the definition of omega and the definition of k, you'll recall that omega was twice pi the frequency, while k was twice pi divided by the wavelength. Using this substitution, we can see that this phase velocity actually corresponds to the wavelength divided by the period. And so we see that this is intuitively what we would expect of a physical object. As we said, if we have a car, we define its velocity as the amount of space it traverses for a given time. And so this is exactly the same. The wavelength is a spatial period, while the period in the denominator is the temporal or the time period. And so the amount of space the wave covers divided by the amount of time it takes it is again the expected velocity of a wave. Now, this is true for free waves. We will see later that there is a more broad definition called the group velocity. And the group velocity actually gives us the velocity of a wave packet. And in that case, we do not have all the waves traveling at the same speed, and we have something known as dispersion. But at this point, this is enough for us to know that if we have just one frequency, if we have a free wave, it is traveling, and this relation is always satisfied. And if we look at this relation in terms of frequency and wavelength, and if we look at electromagnetic waves, which have the speed of light as their speed, we have the following equation, which is very fundamental. It's true for all waves in general, but particularly for electromagnetic waves is our interest. And this is that the velocity of propagation is equal to the frequency times the wavelength. And just to give you an example, just to show you what this means for a typical electromagnetic waves, let us consider a frequency of 2.4 gigahertz. This is an S-band wave. And so let's consider such an electromagnetic wave and use this equation to get a basic grasp of what its wavelength should be. So substituting very simply the speed of light and this frequency which we're using, we can see that the wavelength is around 12 centimeters. And so you immediately see that in radio waves, which we're going to be talking about, we have wavelengths sometimes quite comparable to our everyday experience. Unlike pure light, which has nanometers in terms of wavelength, radio waves might have much larger wavelength, which allows us to actually incorporate them in our everyday lives, in a sense that our antennas and our receivers, they have a physical size which corresponds to the actual waves emitted and transmitted. And we will see later on that the wavelength of a wave has very much to do with what antennas we use to emit or receive them. And so the size, if you like, the length that it has, determines our antennas and our tools that we use.